We're trying to balance them out. Yeah.
The Lord be with you. Grace and peace to you in the Lord Jesus Christ. And welcome to this service of worship here on the Lord's Day. We are Cedar Heights Community Presbyterian Church. And as always, my friends and siblings in Christ, it is our joy, pleasure, and privilege to have you worshiping with us this day. Whether that's in person here in the sanctuary or via the magical interwebs, via Facebook Live, we are just so glad that you answered God's call and said yes to worshiping. Again, I say this quite often, that there is no better way to start off the week than to say yes to God's call to come together, fellowship, and worship. So thank you, my friends. It is a joy to see you all. I have three major announcements to share with you this day. One is that Theology Pub is happening this week. And it has had a change of venue. Normally, we've been meeting at Basil Pizza in Waterloo. This week, on Tuesday at 7 o'clock, we'll be meeting at Urban Pie, downtown Cedar Falls. So please join us for that time together. The topic for the evening is being religious versus being spiritual. You've heard this distinction before, talking about those who have been burnt by religion, that sort of conversation we're going to be having. If that interests you, please come. Urban Pie, 7 o'clock this Tuesday. This Saturday is our fall cleanup day. That happens at 9 o'clock a.m. This Saturday, the Buildings and Grounds Committee would surely thank you if you showed up and helped clean up on Saturday morning. And finally, you get an awesome pictorial announcement about this in your bulletin. The annual hayride is next Sunday. So if you haven't responded to us, please tell me today. Let us know that you plan to be there. It's always a fun time for friends and family. You have the handy schedule of the hayrides right there. So please let us know if you plan to join us for that hayride. And now, my friends, let us prepare our hearts and minds to worship the living God. Thank you. Y'all, let me tell you something. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. At this time, I would invite you to please rise in body or in spirit and join me in this morning's call to worship. We worship the living God whose giving knows no ending. Our time is yours, O God. We worship Jesus Christ who revealed true love to us. Our talents are yours, O Christ. We worship the Holy Spirit, who leads us into all truth. Our treasures are yours, O Spirit. Let us worship the Lord, the God of generosity. Please join us in our opening song of praise.
Now is the time to worship. Come. Now is the time to give your heart. Come. Just as you are to worship. Come. Just as you are before your God.
Scripture and experience teaches us that we all sin and fall short of the glory of God. We all have our shortcomings. For example, I forgot, as my own shortcoming this morning, to welcome anyone who may be visiting today. Thank you for visiting with us today. We hope you feel at home here and that one day, by God's grace, you may even feel led to become part of this family. So thank you for visiting with us. Friends, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, our God is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So I invite you to join me this morning in our corporate prayer of confession, followed by a moment of silent personal reflection. Friends, let us pray with one voice. Creator God, with each breath of life you breathe, you give gifts to your creation, calling us to use your gifts to build up your kingdom on earth. We confess that sometimes we don't see your gifts for the treasures they are. We either take credit for them ourselves, or we dismiss them as not important. We privilege some gifts over others, forgetting that you care about tiny things as much as big things. And when we're called upon to use our gifts for your glory, so often we find ourselves distracted by our own desire and uncertain of your direction. Forgive us. Open us up to hear you speaking. Open our hearts to embrace your purpose. In the name of the risen Christ, we pray. Amen. Hear the good news, siblings in Christ. As far as the east is from the west, so far does God remove our transgressions from us, and God does not do this reluctantly or begrudgingly. God does it with excitement. God does it with joy. It is a joyful thing for God to offer us God's mercy. So let us receive God's mercy with gladness, know and believe that in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. I'm Julie Book, and I'm on the Board of Deacons here at Cedar Heights, and I'm happy to be worshiping with you here this morning, either in person or online. And so we want to share the peace together. Grounded in grace, let us celebrate the peace we have received in Jesus Christ by sharing it with one another and with the whole world. May the peace of Christ be with you.
Before we turn to God's holy word in scripture, let us first turn to God in prayer. Let us pray. God of our whole selves, God of the universe, we pray that at this moment that you would still our disquieted hearts and souls, that you would send your Holy Spirit into this place or wherever we happen to be at this very moment, pry open our hearts of stone and help us to receive with joy and with sincerity what you would have to say to us this morning. For we ask it in Jesus' name, amen. Our first reading of scripture this morning, our Old Testament lesson, comes from the book of Ecclesiastes, a very familiar text for some people. Hear this word from Ecclesiastes chapter 3. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones, and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek, and a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to throw away, a time to tear, a time to sow, a time to keep silence, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. What gain have the workers from their toil? We turn from those wise words from the Old Testament to the book of Acts, also written by Luke, by the way. This is Luke's second volume, if you will, the sequel to Luke's gospel. Our New Testament lesson comes from Acts chapter 1, verses 6 through 9. This is the story of Jesus' ascension into heaven. Hear God's word to you from Acts chapter 1. So when they had come together, they asked Jesus, "Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel?" Jesus replied, "It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." When Jesus had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. These men said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus who has been taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." These are the words of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And at this time, I would like to invite the children forward for their time with Jennifer Garrett this morning. Come on down, my friends. Jennifer.
Hey, friends, come on down. It's good to see you all. You guys may have heard today Reverend Johnny read a passage that had the word season in it. And when I think of seasons, I think of fall and winter and spring and summer. Do you guys have a favorite season? You like summer?
What about? Winter.
Winter, okay. Winter. Now, sometimes if we have a favorite, that might mean we also have a least favorite, a time we don't really like. Anybody have a season they don't like? No, no. I don't sometimes like winter. I don't like cold feet. I don't like it when I have to shovel the snow. Well, we also have seasons of life. We have times when we're little. We have times when we go to school. We have times where we're grown-ups. And so as we think about these seasons, we have to remember God is with us all the time. He's with us when we're laughing and happy. And he's with us when we're crying and sad. He's with us when we're young and when we're in school and when we get older. God is with us all the time. And you know what? God doesn't have a favorite season. He is just there for us. So let's have a prayer together. I'll say a part and you say it back. Dear God, thank you for the seasons. Thank you for always being with us. Amen. Oh, if you're in preschool or fourth grade, you can go with Janelle over here. If you're older than fourth grade, head back to your seat. Okay, you go with Janelle.
Oh, gosh. All right.
To everything, turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, turn, turn. And a time for every purpose under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die. A time to plant, a time to reap. A time to kill, a time to heal, a time to laugh, a time to weep. Through everything season turn, and a time for every purpose under heaven. A time of love, a time of great, a time of war, a time of peace, a time to lay and praise, a time to refrain from embracing. To everything turn, there is a season turn, and a time for every purpose under heaven. A time to gain, a time to lose, a time to rend, a time to sow, a time of love, a time of hate, a time of peace. I swear it's not too late. Everything turn. There is a season turn, and a time for every purpose under heaven.
How about our music ministry, y'all? That was just awesome. Wow. We could just like go home right now, basically, right? Let us pray. Oh God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts together be pleasing in your sight. O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. They say it takes 21 days to form a habit, something like that. But you know, that's a bit too optimistic, I think. Studies from the real world actually teach us that it could take anywhere from 18 to 200 54 days for that new habit to really take hold and become automatic, to really become a part of us. Now, that's a long time, don't you think? 18 to 254 days? That's a lot of effort. It's a lot of dedication and a whole lot of intentionality. Might even make us want to give up before we start. Before we really give it our best try. I feel that repentance is kind of like that. Or at least it can feel like that. True repentance is hard. It's hard. It takes time. It can require all of our energies, all our focus. And there's a good chance that it might not take. That we might fail. We may have to start all over. And I understand how discouraging that can be. I get it. But here's the thing. Here's some good news. No matter how many times we fail and fall flat on our faces, no matter how many times we have to start all over again, and no matter how many times we just kind of throw our hands up in the air and give up before we even try, God never gives up on us. God is love, and love never fails. I know this from experience, based on my own vast multitude of mistakes. Could go on and on. And I know this because it's one of the most consistent messages in the Bible. Y'all, this is This is Bible 101, okay? And we see this message played out yet again here this morning at the beginning of Acts. The book of Acts, that is. You see, Jesus' disciples are absolutely notorious for their misunderstanding. I mean, they are stubborn to the nth degree. Over and over again, they just don't get it. And it's a terrible thing to be remembered for when you think about it. But we see perhaps the most glaring, the most egregious example of that right here in Acts. You got to keep in mind, this is the risen Christ that's talking here. This is after Easter. For heaven's sake, y'all, Jesus has already died. He's been raised. He's been appearing to people left and right, and now he's about to take his place at God's side. Jesus will ascend to heaven and be seated at the right hand of the Father. Soon and very soon, the Holy Spirit will come on the day of Pentecost, just as Jesus promised, and give birth to the church. Yes, it's true. The disciples, Jesus' closest friends, have been through a lot by this point, right? They've been through a great deal. And so I try to give them the benefit of the doubt. I try to assume the best, to not be overly harsh and make them into some kind of caricature. We do this all the time, by the way, especially to the Pharisees and the Jewish religious leaders of the day, turn them into some kind of foil or sideshow. But we do the same with the disciples too. We misjudge them. We judge them too harshly. And we mock their lack of understanding. But in this case, I'd be remiss not to point out this particular terrible blunder by Jesus' inner circle. In fact, it would be irresponsible of me not to show you this just next level stubbornness on display here. Again, this isn't to shame Jesus' disciples. I'm not here to point or wag my self-righteous finger at Jesus' traumatized friends. I'm pointing it out because we, too, are stubborn, folks. And we do much the same thing today. It just looks a little different. We express the same stubborn desire as they do. We just frame it differently. We use a different vocabulary, one we're more comfortable with, one that we recognize. You see, we too want to go back. We want to go back. Remember when? Right? This, my friends, is basically what the disciples are doing and saying. That's what they mean when they ask the resurrected Christ, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? Is this it, Jesus? Is this the time, Lord? Have we finally reached that moment when you will take us back to greatness? When you, having conquered death, will now give those brutal Roman oppressors exactly what they deserve? Is this the time? Remember when, Jesus? Remember before these evil Romans? Remember when it was we who were great? Remember back before the Persian Empire? Remember way back before the Babylonians when we had that bright, beautiful temple built by Solomon? Remember, Jesus, when it was we who were the conquerors? When we were the ones to be feared? Gosh, things were so wonderful back then. And they can be great again, Jesus. You can make that happen. You have the power. A cross couldn't stop you. Death couldn't stop you. Certainly, you can put these Romans in their place and bring us back to how strong we were when King David reigned over Israel. Let's go back. But for everything, there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. Jesus' friends want to go back. Back, you know, remember when? But this is not the time to go back, Jesus says. Jesus, the ever patient, ever gracious, master of reminders, gives his disciples then and his disciples now one last reminder before he's taken up into heaven. This is the time to move forward. Not to retreat into our comfortable patterns. Not to fall back into, well, that's just how we've always done things. No, this is the time to get moving. This is the time to rely on God's faithfulness and steadfast love from generation to generation, never waning, never failing, always showing up, never leaving us alone. Here's what Jesus says in Acts. It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. In other words, friends, you're asking the wrong questions. It's not for you to know when God's kingdom will come in its fullness, in all its glory, bringing an end to wars and suffering and oppression. That's not for us to know, Jesus says. But, until that great and glorious day comes, here's what you can be doing. Here's what you should be doing. And by God's grace, here's what you will be doing. It's not for you to know the times, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses. You're asking the wrong questions, my beloved. How about asking what you will do with the power you receive from the Holy Spirit? Because the Spirit is coming, just as I've said, and the Holy Spirit will bless you with a power that would make David tremble. A power to liberate. A power to protect the vulnerable, to snuff out unjust systems, a power to bring about a more fair and equitable world. You're going to have that power very soon. So what are you going to do with it? What part will you play in my church to reflect God's love and God's light in all the earth? Christ commands his disciples to turn the other cheek. And they still want to strike Rome back with an iron fist. They want to fight fire with fire, a fire rooted in fear, where there is no love to be found. They want to repay evil for evil rather than overcoming evil with good. They'd rather punish their persecutors than pray for them. Remember, the way of Christ is never violence, vengeance, retaliation, or bloodshed. No, says Jesus, it's not about what I'm going to do. I'm ascending. I'm returning to the Father just like I said I would. I have done what God put me into this body to do. Now, my friends, now it's about what you're going to do. It's about what we're going to do. What we're going to do with our time, with our talents, and our treasures. What are we going to do with the power we have, with the gifts of the Spirit that we've received? Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? Is it? Are we there yet? It's not for you to know the times, but for heaven's sake, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, just as I promised, and you will be my witnesses. Siblings in Christ, we too are asking the wrong questions. Let's be frank with each other about that. Because the Holy Spirit has come and given us power to move mountains. And yet we've somehow warped our nostalgia for the church of the past into some kind of idol that we hope to resurrect. Lord, is this the time when you'll restore the church to how it used to be? Is this the time where you'll make people come back to church and fill our sanctuaries and fill our coffers and convince us that this institution will survive and thrive forever, just as we've always known it and conceived of it? Is this the time? Do we not believe that God is powerful enough to move hearts and minds, even if the church isn't replicating the practices of past decades? Whether or not our children or our grandchildren have the exact same church experience as we did growing up, the good news is that God is still mighty enough to pierce through all the distractions and white noise of the world. Because that same Spirit given to us by Christ, the one promised to us before his ascension, the one to come and set our hearts on fire and empower us to flip over corrupt tables, that same Spirit is still here and stronger than ever. So know this truth. Know this truth, my friends. It was never our job to immortalize an institution. It was never our job to make the church into our image. Never our job to prolong the mechanisms of something ultimately founded by Christ and sustained by the Holy Spirit. The church belongs to Christ, not us. And it'll undergo changes and reformations, yes. But God's grace is sufficient to equip us for whatever the Lord requires. No matter what the church looks like or whatever shape it takes in the future, steeple or no steeple, pews or no pews, building or no building. After all, for everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to break down and a time to build up. But make no mistake, as the world keeps turning, the church will keep ministering. We will keep shining as long as we don't withhold our time, our talents, and our treasures. Siblings in faith, Christ is reminding us of the power entrusted to us. Christ is encouraging us to ask the right questions. And it's not, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? And it's not, Lord, is this the time when you will take us back to the golden age of the church, to some mythical, perfect Thomas Kincaid picturesque image? No, there's no going back. And this isn't a pessimistic view. It's one brimming with opportunity, one that's ripe for real, meaningful ministry that can change lives. No, the only way to move is forward. Not staring up at the heavens in a stupor waiting for something big to happen. The only way to go is wherever he's going. Be it into an uncertain season of the church, or down into green pastures, perhaps beside still waters, or even directly through the valley of the shadow of death. No matter where we're going, know that we always go with God. The Lord's staff and rod always present to pull us back from the edge. Know that the Spirit has already gone ahead of us to prepare our precise path. You see, our assurance, we human beings like to be certain about things, you know? We don't like mystery. But our assurance, our hope, our certainty comes from the fact that even if we don't know where exactly it is we're going or where exactly we're going to end up, we know the way because we know who the way is. The way isn't the name of a road or a direction or even a set of doctrinal standards or beliefs. Jesus is the way. Jesus is the way in every season and in every century of the church. Jesus is the way. Because in reality, it was never about our destination. God took care of that long ago with this. Here in this life, it's about the journey. And you already know the way. You know him. One final thought. If you know me, well at all, then you know that I'm terrible with directions. I'm so bad. I can't get anywhere without Apple Maps. Is anybody else like that? Oh, come on, be honest. And yet, I can always tell you the best way to go, no matter where you're going. I'll see you on the way. Amen. This time I would again invite you to rise in body or spirit and join us in our second hymn. It is number 835, Just a Closer Walk with Thee. At this time, I would like to invite my friend Chad Abbas forward for a moment for stewardship, and I believe he's going to be accompanied by a visual aid. Thank you, Kim. Chad?
To answer Jennifer's question earlier, I would say that fall is my favorite time of the year, certainly, and it's not just because of the stewardship campaign. So, in all seriousness, today marks the kickoff of our 2023 stewardship campaign. There will be information going out to everyone with pledge cards and everything leading up to Consecration Sunday on November 13th. This year's stewardship campaign, the committees have done an excellent job of pulling together information for which we've pulled together a budget, a preliminary budget for 2023. And there are a lot of needs of the church. And so today, hopefully, we can kind of go through and lay out the what those needs are. I believe the greatest way to do this is to be transparent and to let everyone know what the needs are, and that's hopefully the best way that you can respond. So in regards to the budget, first of all, obviously there's revenue, income coming in, expenses going out. The first item that we'll cover is the decreases in the budgeted revenue that we're forecasting for next year. First item up there is unpledged income. But the majority of our members pledge, and we certainly thank you all for that, and we would encourage everyone to do that. Back in 2019, we lost a significant donor, and in 2020, there were some significant unpledged income, both by people who pledge and people who do not pledge. That number has continued to stay in the budget in 2021 and 2022. However, the realism of it is that we're about $10,000 short of what we have in the budget for unpledged income, and so we need to make that up somewhere. The next item, back in 2020 with COVID, the church was a benefactor of the PPP, the Paycheck Protection Plan income. What happened there is with businesses struggling, they could apply for money from the SBA. We applied for that. We were fortunate enough to receive 50-some thousand dollars. 40-some thousand of that came into the budget. Because that loan was forgiven, it came into the budget in 2021, and 11,000 came into our budget for 2022. That $11,000 will not be there going forward, so that'll be a loss of revenue going forward. The next item, we are fortunate to have memorial and endowment. The endowment itself, the way it's set up, is 4% of the endowment balance as of June 30th is brought into income, brought into the operating budget each year. And so, unfortunately, as we're all aware of, the stock market has taken a hit and the endowment fund has decreased a fair amount within the last year. So that endowment subsidy that we're going to be getting into the operating campaign, into the operating budget, is going to be about $2,000 less than what it was here for 2022. The last item is for 2022, the year we're in right now, we had budgeted a deficit of $9,200. And so obviously our goal would be to make that up and not be in a deficit position going forward. So with that, that's another $9,200 that we would need to add. So before we even look at what the expenditure increases are, we're looking at a total decrease in revenue of $32,200 for 2023. So if we transition to what the budgeted expenditures are, all the committees have done an excellent job in trying to keep their requests to a minimum, knowing that we have these decreases in revenue. And there's one primary category that we're looking at that we feel does have some needs for 2023. But the committees have done an excellent job. So the first item, when we look, what I'll just kind of classify collectively as the administration, Christian education, and buildings and grounds. Those increases total about $8,300. And working backwards on that, the buildings and grounds increases are the most significant, and around that are utilities. When we did the budget for 2022, we were hopeful that some of the improvements that had been done to the church would reduce the utilities or not make it quite as high. Well, the truth of the matter is those the budget for utilities is going to have to increase about $4,000. So the significant portion of that is utilities. Also included there would be the insurance. There's been an increase in the insurance rates as well, and so that would be another increase. On the administration side, we have computer support costs. For many years, we have budgeted that at a low dollar amount, and for recent years, every year we have exceeded that amount. And so we're going to try to get that more realistic, but you know, we're all relying upon computers anymore, and that cost is going to stay there, unfortunately. Also, in regards to administration, is there's additional bank fees that we're paying. And you might ask, why are we paying bank fees? Well, there were many people that started paying their pledges electronically, which is great. With COVID, that even accelerated that further, of course. And so there's bank fees associated with that. And so that's going to be an increase that we haven't brought up to the level that we need to, for 2023. And then Christian education, the primary increase there that we're looking at is transportation costs for the youth. So the most significant, the next item on there, are personnel salary increases. So in 2021, we really did not give any raises to any of our staff. In 2022, there were minimal raises given to our staff. So one of the new positions that we had to hire for approximately a year ago was a new janitor, a new custodian. When we put out an application for that, we did not receive a very strong response on that, and we had to hire someone for $25 an hour, and that was significantly higher than what we were paying before. Fortunately, Tim Klatt decided to come back and perform that position for $20 an hour. But we have three positions, significant positions within the church that still pay a rate of less than $20 an hour when we look at their salary. Those three positions are communications coordinator, director of children's ministry, and office administrator. And so we feel a need to raise their levels up to at least that $20 an hour equivalent. The fourth individual, Johnny, you know, continues to do a great job for us, obviously. He is at the low end of what the presbytery recommends for a pastor salary. We're looking at a 5% increase for Johnny. Nothing significant. It's still going to keep him on the low end, but we feel it's important to give him that 5% raise. Now, Dave has been totally supportive of this. He actually had decided himself to forego any sort of payroll increase because he feels that these four positions are more important to get them to the level that we need to get them for. And it's not just the individuals, those individuals do a great job, but we need to position ourselves for the future also, because if we don't, we're going to have a lot of sticker shock when we have to replace them, hopefully not anytime soon. The third item is pension and major medical, or medical increases. Our pastors, through the presbytery, the Board of Pensions, we pay to them an amount based on their salaries. And for the last few years, that percentage that the Board of Pensions has required has been 37%. The Board of Pensions has raised that to 39% going forward. So that, coupled with an increase to Johnny's salary, would amount to about $4,000. And then the last item that relates to personnel as well is the payroll tax increase based on those salary increases, and that's about $1,500. So when we total that all up, we have $28,800 of expenses, which we have truly tried to keep to a minimum. So when we look at this, and we go to the overall budget summary, when we look at the increases in the budgeted, or the decreases in the budgeted revenues of $32,200, budgeted expenditure increases of $28,800, we're looking at a need of $61,000. And that is significant. You know, it's daunting. But again, the whole goal here is to be transparent with the congregation. I don't want to belabor the point, but when you go back, our PPP money really just kind of covered up. We were fortunate to have that. It really just covered up the fact that when we lost a significant donor, we have still not recovered from that. Ultimately, what we receive for pledges is going to help determine what we have for a budget. We are fortunate to have some reserves, and we'll determine what the final budget is. But at $61,000, that's a 15.7% increase in pledges. And like I said, it's daunting. So anyway, we're asking for your assistance. We're asking for your help. We ask that you prayerfully consider what you might pledge for 2023 when we have Consecration Sunday on November 13th. If there are any questions, I don't want to address them now with timing, but don't hesitate to let me know, and I'd be happy to talk with you about them. Thank you.
Thanks, Chad. Thank you very much, my friend. As we come before God in prayer this day, we always do so in a spirit of humility and hope. Some of you may not know about me that when I was a teenager, I ended up somehow in a Southern Baptist youth group. I don't know. We can talk about that. We can talk about that later. Anyway, one of the common vernaculars that you hear in the Southern Baptist tradition is, you know, God has put something on my heart this morning. And God has put something on my heart this morning. And so I feel led this morning to pray for our indigenous siblings today. So God's put that on my heart this morning, so that's what I'm going to do. What concerns and celebrations do you have this day? Yeah. Yes. Yes, the many injuries around, we will certainly be praying for their recovery. Thank you. Yeah, Jordan.
Prayers for the people of Iran as they are now on week 3 of ever increasing protests against their government.
Thank you. Thank you. Jerry.
Prayers for a longtime friend of mine named Nick, who is now suffering some of the worst symptoms of ALS. Mm.
Thank you. Other concerns? Don't want to miss anybody? Okay. Let us go to God in prayer. God of goodness and grace, God of joy and justice, we come before you this day and hopefully offering you our whole selves. God, we thank you that you know what is on our tongue even before we speak it. You love us enough that every hair on our head is numbered. And so, God, we lift up to you everything that's weighing us down, preventing us, inhibiting us from serving you faithfully and fully in this world today. Lifting up to you our concerns, our joys, our celebrations, our reservations, our doubts, all that stuff, oh God, you know it all already. Lord, we pray for Julie Rathmel and her family after her nephew Cody passed away from colon cancer at the age of 50. God, we ask that you would be present, Lord, that you would comfort them in their grief, that your spirit would surround them with your tangible and palpable love. Lord, we ask that you would be present with all those who are grieving this day. Whether that grief is a very recent, acute loss, or whether they're remembering someone from 30 years ago, God, we pray that you would be present with all of us who know the pain and heartache of a lost loved one. God, we pray for all of our members who happen to be injured in various ways this day, oh God. God put them on a path to as speedy a recovery as possible and be with those who are caring for them as they recover from these injuries. Lord, we pray also for Jerry's friend Nick, suffering some of the worst symptoms from ALS now. God, we pray that you would be with all those who suffer from similar conditions, for those conditions that have no cure. God, we pray for those researchers and scientists hard at work every day to find miracles that you put in this world. And God, you are present everywhere. You love everyone created in your image. And so we pray for those concerns around your good creation, around this earth. Pray for continuing tensions between China and Taiwan. Pray for the ongoing war in Russia and Ukraine. God, we pray for an end to all that. We pray for a peaceful, just resolution. We pray for the nation of Iran, O God. After ongoing weeks of political tensions and violence and protest, Lord, we pray for justice there as well. We pray that in every corner of the world, your will might be done on earth as it is in heaven. And so, Lord, we pray in a spirit of collective, communal repentance when it comes to our indigenous siblings in faith, not just those here in the United States experiencing a terrible genocide and a trail of tears and innumerable atrocities, O Lord, but we pray for indigenous communities around the world who have experienced similar fates, similar experiences, similar destruction. Lord, we must not just repent individually, we have to repent as a society, as a nation, as a collective. God, give us the courage of conviction to do so, to take those necessary steps. And finally, O Lord, we pray for this particular church community as we indeed enter into another annual stewardship campaign, focusing this year on our time, our talents, and our treasures. God, because we know that stewardship is so much more, about so much more than money. So help us to give it all to you, knowing that all we have is a loan. Lord, that you bless us so that we can be a blessing to other people. Lord, we pray this in the name of our crucified and risen Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught his disciples then and his disciples now to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now, in response to everything that God has given us, let us worship the Lord with our living and our giving.
Thank you.
before I pray. Speaking of time and talents, thank you, Jasmine. That was just awesome. Let us pray. God, we thank you for the gifts that you give us so that we can be a blessing to others. Lord, we offer our gifts to you this day so that you might multiply them, make a miracle of them so that they might get to where they are needed the most. For we ask it in Jesus' name, amen. Please join us for our closing hymn, my friends. It is 462. I love to tell the story. And now, my friends, may you go in peace. May you live as free people. Take up your ministry with courage and do not be daunted by the enormity of this world's grief. Do justice now. Love mercy now. Walk humbly now. You're not obligated to complete the work, but neither are you free to abandon it. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit that will never let you go be with you now and forevermore. Amen.